these beautiful faces out here, and some that we've not seen for a little while, and some that we see a lot. And you know, the one thing about it is we see everybody, whether we're physically together, but we see each other when we're alone and praying to God just to keep everybody safe and to bless everybody and protect our church family. And it's just great to be in God's house and see everybody. If you would, get your Rejoice hymnal. Stand with us. Turn to page 541. We're going to sing all five verses of He Keeps Me Singing. Because He sure does.
Amen.
Every day.
Brother Russ, Brother Jason, I'm glad He keeps us singing. Good to see each and every one of you with us today, and we're especially happy to have a young lady with us here, Jessica Hibbetts, all the way from Wise, Virginia. Give her a welcome back, amen, to Milligan Free Will Baptist Church. She was a student for a year at Milligan University now. And we appreciate Jessica, and we're just so happy to have you back with us, Jessica. Brother Joel, good to see you. Amen. We love Brother Joel, don't we, church? Amen. A bunch of people's asking about you. So, how's Brother Joel? So, we're happy to have you, Joel, with us. And let's see. We're glad to see each and every one of you here. We do have our daily Bread's devotionals for the months of December through February. They're available in both foyers, so I hope you'll help yourself with that. We're still having Sunday school. I'd like to have you come back and be with us in Sunday school. And you see that, what our theme will be next week. And then, of course, we're in chapter 5 of James. We'll be starting in that chapter Wednesday night. We finished up chapter 4, and we'll be going into chapter 5. We've had a really good study in that. You can see the upcoming dates. The ladies' Christmas party at the home of Cindy Lane at 2 o'clock. If you're planning on attending, there's a sign-up sheet in the front foyer. And they ask you to sign that by November the 23rd. Mask and hand sanitizers will be provided. And we never want to forget this next announcement, and that is?
Jesus is coming.
Let me just share some information with you. We've had some precious people called home to heaven since we last met. One of them, Brother Lawrence Boone. What a wonderful man of God. We miss him, and we will miss him dearly. But I know he's with Jesus. And our hearts and prayers go out to the Sister Mary Boone and all the children and grandchildren. And let me say, tomorrow is going to be a graveside service, sort of a private ceremony. And they do have plans on having a celebration of life service here at the church to honor Brother Lawrence. So we'll let you know more about that as we find out more about it. Also, remember Brother Fred Gouge's family. He had a brother that passed away, Floyd, down in Alabama. So our prayers and thoughts go out to the Gouge family. Also, the Moore family. Brother Carl went to be at the Lord. Sister Carla's grandpa, her pa. So he's a wonderful man, and we will miss him. Then let's remember the Trent family. This is a real good friend of Brother Scott's. Is Laura the girl, the young lady that got killed in Elizabeth and in a car accident? So everybody, please remember the Trent family in your prayers. And a lot of you know Brother Anthony Johnson. He's a neighbor to the Hickses, Sister Taylor's daddy mama. Went to Valley Forge Free Will Baptist Church. I understand a wonderful man and loved the Lord. He leaves behind his wife, I believe he's 52, and leaves behind his wife and 5 children. So let's really lift our voices up in prayer for all of these families. And thank God, I'm looking forward to that day when all of God's family can gather around the throne together. There won't be any more cancer, no more death. You longing for that? No more devil, no more temptation. The Lord's coming back, and that is our hope. And I believe it's sooner than many think. Now, we'll go ahead and get our birthdays. I understand we've got several birthdays here today. All right. You want to put it in there? Put it up here. How old are you there, Mason? Hello? 7. Wow. God bless you, Sister Janice. Brother Wayne's had a birthday? All right. And today's his birthday. Well, happy birthday. Amen. Let's sing happy birthday to these fine people.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And many, many more.
All right. Do we have any wedding anniversaries? Any wedding anniversaries? I know of one. Nana's got one, Paul said. Amen. We love Brother Paul and Sister Nana. Amen.
She said, don't take me in front and don't say that.
You didn't listen to her, did you? Amen.
Hey, what, guys?
After all.
You know, we get up in the morning and we look at each other. And we look at him and say, Lord, how good you are.
Amen.
It's such a blessing to have a companion that'll pray for you.
Amen.
When you're acting, you know, when you're not right yourself, when you're doing things you shouldn't be doing, she's praying.
Amen.
It's such a blessing. And I thank God for our church and how they prayed for us. I'm sure the prayers of our church has brought us through a lot in the companionship and the fellowship. And I just thank God. Thank God for this sweet lady. Precious.
Amen. Love you, Brother Paul, Sister Nina. Amen. Amen. They're two of my heroes. Amen. And I got a little taste, nothing like what they have to do to prepare to come to church. When I got hurt, we had to get up extra early just to get me ready. Bless Sister Kathy's heart, because I weigh a lot more than she does, bless her heart. And I was dependent on her. And
treading on thin ice.
Yeah, that's right. But we love you all. 49 years, right? 49 years, amen. Let's sing happy anniversary to them, brother, for us.
Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary, God bless you. Happy anniversary to you and many more.
All right, Brother Clinton's got an announcement to make to the church. Amen. Bless him, Lord.
We would like to thank everybody for your prayers, hopes, cards, everything that you sent during COVID. Funerals are a little different. Nobody wants to walk around, shake hands, and swap snot on shoulders. But the fact is, we still felt the love of this church.
Amen.
We got a good chunk of money. We got about half what we were looking for. And it really made me happy that you guys really came to and helped out these children who were in need. And Brother Russ, he said, hey, if you meet that, I'll give you $750 to make it $2,000, which would be uniforms for 400 kids. So, I go on, and my dad asked me, how much did you get? I said, well, we're about halfway. I said, we'll get it. I said, we've got it. So, let's give them the gift. So then my dad said,
amen.
The best news for you.
Good news. That's good news.
Amen. Amen.
I appreciate everybody's gift. I know there's some gave five, some gave 50. It don't matter what you gave. You gave what you could. You gave what God put on your heart.
Amen.
I appreciate that more than anything.
Amen.
We also have a fund started to get Norbert back home so we can give them this money.
Yeah. Amen.
I mean, God's doing great work with Norbert, and he needs all the help he can get back over there.
Amen.
So I think we can definitely knock it out of the park on getting him back too, because I know I haven't had a chance to give yet, because I was going to give for that when I saw what was left, but opportunity's gone, so I'm going to be giving to getting him back over there.
Amen.
But I do appreciate everybody for helping us in this endeavor that we've done. It was kind of short notice, but everybody stepped up, and I appreciate it so much. I know y'all be blessed by it.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Brother Norbert, stand up. Let everybody see you right here. We appreciate Brother Norbert. Amen. Let me just say, he has a wonderful children's ministry there. They minister to kids that are abused. They and sex trafficking. They get them out of that environment. And that's a lot of kids, isn't it? Over 400 children that they minister to. And also, when he goes back, finally, he's wanting to start a Free Will Baptist Church. Isn't that great? He's wanting to start a church. So we're excited about that. I wanted to give you the latest total what we have raised so far. You've given $525. So we need $1,475. Brother Norbert, $2,000, that'll get you a round trip on it. There and back here. All right. So I know we're going to do it. So if you haven't given anything, I know the Lord will bless you, okay? As soon as we can get this, the better, too. So how we're doing this, if you want to write a check out, just make that out to the church. Earmark it to Norbert's plane ticket. And Brother West is going to write him one check so he can put it in the bank and he can go ahead and transfer and get that flight. So or you can give cash. You can give it to Kathy. Give it to me, whoever, or Wes, give it to him. He's keeping a tab on it all, and we are too. So let's get this knocked out, okay, as soon as we can. I got a question for you. Anybody in this place love Jesus?
Amen.
I tell you what, it's a fact. He loves you and me. Let's see. I believe I've already done our offerings. And let's see. We did say Jesus is coming, amen, did we do? Amen. And, well, let's everybody stand just for a moment. Will you stand, please? All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we lift up all these precious families that we called their name out just a few minutes ago, how we love them, and Father, we just ask that you would just comfort them with the Holy Spirit and be near and dear to them today. Lord, we thank you for Brother Lawrence Boone and his service here at Milligan Free Will Baptist Church. And Lord, a choir member, a trustee, Lord, just a greeter at the door. He's just a great man. And we miss him. But we know, Father, that he's with you. And Lord, someday you're going to take us to be with yourself as well. Now, Lord, we just ask that the sweet Holy Spirit will just move in a powerful way here today. Lord, get glory and get honor and praise out of this service. If there's someone here that's lost, we ask that you would save them. Father, just move and have your sweet will and way, and we'll thank you for all that you do in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to go ahead and dismiss our children's church. And Brother Russ has got our specials today. You pray for him as he comes to sing. Amen. Amen.
It's really good to see Joel this morning.
Amen.
Been praying for him a lot. As I pray for everybody at church and a lot of other things, but, you know, Joel, him and I have a pretty special connection with both of us doing the same kind of work for many years. And really, our paths never crossed except one time. And, you know, you really strive to grow and want to do your best in life, and and I'm, you know, none of us are perfect at all. You know, I believe it or not, I've done a lot of things in my life that I'm ashamed of. But, you know, God took that from me and
Amen.
Said, don't worry about it.
Amen.
And, you know, if I could be one-tenth of the person that Joel is, I've done well. Love you, buddy.
Amen.
Another person yesterday that really I didn't, well, I know that he's had a hard life and not always lived the life of God or lived a Christian life. And come to find out that within the past week his life has turned around and he's gotten saved.
Amen.
And come to know Jesus. And
mm-hmm.
You know, he shared something with me yesterday. I don't remember the whole thing about it, but basically, pretty much, it's a story or something that he told me that he had read, and I got the call from him out of the blue yesterday. He just said he was thinking of me, and the reason he said he was thinking of me is he saw one of my commercials on TV. He probably got a good laugh out of that, but he said, you know, he had read about this lady that was in the grocery store, and she knocked over a big display, and everything fell to the floor and broke. I'm sure, has anybody heard this before or read it or something, but he shared this with me. And he said the lady was distraught and everything and something, and one of the store manager came up and said, don't worry about it, and she said, I don't have the money to pay for it. And he said, well, we've got insurance for that. And then the story goes on that basically if you look at the broken pieces that we have,
mm-hmm.
all of our faults, all of the things that we've done,
mm-hmm.
all our baggage,
yeah,
and we just throw it down on the ground, all those broken pieces, we've got insurance for it too.
Amen.
And that's Jesus. We've got insurance through him.
Amen.
It's already paid for.
Thank
paid
God.
For by his blood.
Amen.
And we don't have to ever worry about it. And, you know, it's just honoring him and something that I strive to do every day. And Mark asked me this morning when I came, got in here, and it's exactly how it happened. He said, you know, did I ask you to do our specials today? I said, well, no. He said, did you get my text?
Yeah.
Well, I got his text at 9:30 last night because it was a long day at work yesterday, and we were super covered up, and... And I had something like 20-some texts last night I was reading on the way home from work, which I know I shouldn't be doing while I'm driving. I understand. That's. I just told myself, that's true, this is all true, so I'll just tell you. Yes, I was reading them on the way home from work, but my car drives itself. I hit a button, it steers, it drives, it does it all, so I can sit there, but you're still supposed to keep your eyes
goodness.
On the road. But sometimes I don't.
Yeah.
Still selling.
Yeah, it's funny.
But so I really didn't know what I was going to sing today. And there's a box in the front seat of my car that I pulled out of the closet, and it's got all the whole bunch of CDs and everything in it, and I'm going through them on the way in here, and I am not singing a single song that I listened to, because when I got here, God took over.
Amen.
And Norma was down here when I was singing. I couldn't get through them. I broke down in one of them, and I know when that happens, God's
Amen.
Telling me that's what I want.
Amen.
Let's go to track four first, not track one. Let's go to track four, please. Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with pain, headed who knows where. On they go through private pain, living fear to fear, laughter hides the silent cries, only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open door. People need the Lord. When will we realize people need the Lord?
Here's something we should do all the time. We are called to take His light to a world where wrong seems right. What could be too great a cost for sharing life with one who's lost? Through His love our hearts can feel all the grief they bear. They must hear the words of life. Only we can share. Bring my mic down if you don't care, please. Thank you.
places empty, no more traffic in the streets. All the builders' tools are silent, no more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth is all suspended as the king comes through the gate. King is coming. The king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Happy faces line the hallways, those whose lives have been redeemed. Broken homes he has mended, those from prison he has freed. Little children and the aged, hand in hand, stand all aglow, who were crippled, broken, ruined, clad in garments white as snow. Oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. I can hear the chariots rumble, I can see the marching throng. The flurry of God's trumpet spells the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolded, heaven's grandstands are in place, heaven's choir is now assembled, starts to sing Amazing Grace. Oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. It's all right. Amen. Amen. Sister Amy's been having a lot of trouble. Bless her heart, with her head, just real bad migraines. And she asked us to anoint her with oil. Could I ask our elders, our brothers and sisters in Christ, want to come and join us here? We believe in practicing James chapter 5. We believe the power we know is in the Lord. Amen. And in his name. So we're going to anoint our sister, and we're going to believe the Lord's going to take away. How many believes the Lord can take away these headaches?
Amen.
I know it. I know he can do it. Amen. I know he can do it. He's a mighty God. Amen. Join us in this prayer as we anoint her. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we anoint our sister Amy. Lord, you know the pain that she's been having in her head. And Lord, we know, according to your word, you said let them ask for the elders of the church. And Lord, we're anointing our dear sister Amy in your name, Lord Jesus. And we're asking right now, Lord, that you would lay your healing hand upon her body and make her whole. We know, Lord Jesus, you shed your blood for our sins. But your word says, by your stripes we are healed. So, Lord, we claim that healing right now. Touch Sister Amy. Let her feel it right now. Let her feel your power. Let her feel your touch from her head all the way to her feet and her toes. Touch her now, Lord Jesus. We give you the glory. In your name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. Gonna be all right, sister. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Wonderful to be in the house of the Lord, isn't it? Amen. Open your Bibles with me to Acts. Acts chapter 24. I'm just going to read one verse. Would you stand, please, in reverence to God's holy word? Acts chapter 24 and verse number 25. Here's what the Lord has had on my heart to preach to you today. A trembling man. A trembling man. The word of the Lord. Let's just go up and read verse 24 as well. And after certain days, when Felix came with his wife Drusilla, which was a Jewish, he sent for Paul and heard him concerning the faith in Christ. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, "Go thy way, for this time, when I have a convenient season, I will call for thee." Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your holy word that we've just read. Now I ask, Lord, that you will anoint me with the Holy Spirit. Help me remember what I've studied. And Lord, especially that one that may be here today that's lost, or one backslidden, get a hold of their hearts. Lord, challenge us as your people. Lord, that we will be greater witnesses for you. Lord, that we'll never be ashamed to tell others of you, Lord Jesus. Lord, now, have your will and way in this message. And we'll praise you for all that you do in Jesus' name. And all the Lord's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, Felix trembled and answered, "Go thy way, for this time, when I have a convenient season, I will call for thee." A few months previous to our text, the Apostle Paul had set his face toward Jerusalem, saying to those who had prophesied concerning the dangers that awaited him, that would be confronting him, what did Paul say? Paul said, "I am ready not to be bound only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus." He goes to Jerusalem and, escaping scourging by the Jews because he was a Roman citizen, he's brought before the Jewish council for trial, which finally ended in a dissension and a plan by 40 men to kill him. You'll recall that Paul's nephew overheard this plan. And so he went to the chief captain and warned him, and he sent Paul away by night to Caesarea. Now we come to our text. 5 days following, the high priest and the elders came down to Caesarea to try Paul before Felix the governor. Tertullus, a noted lawyer, was brought along to prosecute the case. After Tertullus' speech of accusations, Paul was left to defend himself. You recall in one place Paul, I believe, talked to Timothy. He said that all had turned against him. No man stood with me. But then he said, nevertheless, the Lord stood with me. I'm glad as I stand before you today, I don't stand as a man that is alone. I stand as a man that has the God-man Christ Jesus not only standing here with me, but he's living inside of me. And I'm telling you, church, we don't know what we're going to be faced in the upcoming days or weeks or months or even years. But I do know one thing, that if persecution does increase, that Jesus will get closer to us and we'll get closer to Jesus. And his presence will be more real in our lives than it ever has before. And I say, thank God, yes, the King is coming. And we need to get ready. We need to get our family ready. We need to get our neighbors ready. We need to get as many folk as we can ready to meet the King, because Jesus Christ is coming again. So Paul defends himself, and this is recorded in the 24th chapter. We didn't read the chapter, but of Acts of the Apostles. This scripture affords us the thoughts for what we're going to be looking at today. We're looking at a trembling man. Number one, I want you to notice with me the preacher that we have here in the story. It's Paul. Paul, the man of God, the chosen apostle to the Gentiles, the John the Baptist of the apostles. Paul, the minister who was true to his high calling in Christ Jesus. Paul, the iron man of God, who was not afraid to stand up before rulers of earth and tell them of their sins. There are those who can preach to crowds, but it takes a man with the vision of the cross to preach to just two people. It takes courage to preach to the man who sits in a high position and who has your destiny in his hands. Paul realized his great responsibility to God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, do we realize our great responsibility to God? It's not enough for you and me and our family to know Jesus Christ as personal Lord and Savior. It ought to be our desire that others would come to know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. Yes, we see Paul realized that. Here were a man and a woman that were living in sin, and he had the opportunity to talk to them about the things of eternity. He made use of the opportunity that he had whenever the ministry begins to realize our high calling and our responsibility to God, and we deal with sin in the light of the gospel. There will follow the greatest period of evangelism this world has ever seen. Like you, I'm concerned with the results of this election, but my friend, God still remains the same God. God still is a God of grace. God is still extending his arms of mercy to the lost and dying that are on their way to hell. So let me say, church, come what may, the storms will come, the winds of adversity will appear, but thanks be unto God which giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's time for the church to come out of the dark. It's time for the church to come out of our homes and to come out of our closets and to hit the streets and say, Jesus saves! Jesus saves! Jesus saves! Yes, we know when it's the darkest of times, that's when the light is needed the most. So we see the preacher, Paul. But I also want you to notice with me the audience. It was Felix and his wife Drusilla. Paul was brought before Felix and Drusilla, his wife. We know that Drusilla was the youngest daughter of King Herod Agrippa I. She was a beautiful young Jewish woman, believed to be around 18 years of age. But there were dark shadows lying across her path that would have marred the fairest womanhood. It was not God who made her the wife of Felix. She had been the wife of Azizaz, the king of Emesa, and Felix had stolen her away. and was living in adultery. My friends, the sin of adultery is one of the most terrible, heart-wrecking, and blackening sins of humanity. It has been prevalent in every age. Its arm has reached out into our age with terrible force. I still believe what God therefore hath joined together, let not man put asunder. Till death do you part. Amen. I told Sister Kathy, the only way she's ever going to get rid of me is if the Lord takes me first and I die or she kills me. Could I have an amen? Yes, we believe in the sanctity of marriage. Young sister in Christ, young brother in Christ that's single, you need to exercise care and caution about the mate that you choose to spend the rest of your life with. Number one, a Christian ought to marry another Christian. That is, a man marry a woman. Not a man, not a woman, a woman. You say, preacher, you better not say that. Well, you just heard me say it. Don't step out of one frying pan into another one. Outside of getting saved and serving the Lord and His kingdom, the next greatest decision that a young man or a young woman, an older man or an older woman makes, if you're single, is the spouse that you choose. And the Bible tells us, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. It's time we do it God's way, not our way. Yes, our daily papers are crowded with stories of wrecked homes, sorrowing hearts, suicides, and murders that's been caused by the sin of adultery. Our courts are crowded with divorce cases. It's high time that the pulpit was crying out against this terrible sin. And as the Apostle Paul strike at the head of the evil, whether it be found in the highest society or among the lowest of earth's peoples. He said, preacher, I've been divorced. Will Jesus forgive me? Of course He will. He said, well, I got married again. Well, stay with the one you're married to. Amen? I need to start. Thank you, Brother Wesley. Stay with the one you're married to. I think we can do better than that. Stay with the one you're married to. That's exactly right. Till death do us part. Well, let's get off of that. I want you to notice with me the third thing, and it's the sermon. It was a sermon of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come. Righteousness, when Paul reasoned of righteousness, it's saying he preached the gospel of Christ. He preached unto Felix and Drusilla, Jesus Christ, the crucified, resurrected Lord. We're not here to preach certain denominational beliefs. We're here to preach Jesus. Preaching Free Will Baptist beliefs, preaching Baptist beliefs, preaching Presbyterian beliefs, preaching Methodist beliefs, and I could go on down the list. Will not save one soul. It's preaching Jesus, Him crucified, Him buried, and risen from the dead again, and He's coming back. Jesus is the only one, my friend, that can take you to heaven. If somebody else tells you different, they're telling you a lie. Don't believe them. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. All right. He told the story of Christ to Felix, and he commanded him to accept Him as his Savior. An individual may be moral as Cornelius, but he cannot be righteous until he comes and he does the will of God implicitly as Cornelius in obeying the gospel and becoming a Christian. Paul urged Felix to fulfill all righteousness by accepting Jesus as his Savior. No person can become righteous until he or she has taken this step. What else do we see in this sermon? We see temperance. That word temperance means self-control. Boy, aren't we living in a world that people are just not under control. At this stage in Paul's discourse, he must have hit at the very heart of Felix's sinful life. Here was a man who had dropped into the very cesspool of sin. Self-control was entirely gone. His eyes of lust had captured his heart. He had become so enamored by the beauty of Drusilla that he had induced her to abandon her husband and to come and live with him in open adultery. God planted in man's heart, yes, the passions of life, and when rightly controlled, are a blessing and a help to humanity. But when these God-given passions are abused, they become chains that will drag one to the very depths of sin. Self-control or temperance, what does it mean? You might want to write this down. Here's what it means. The power to hold the reins of conduct in the hand of the will and be able to say no when the case demands it. God's amazing grace does not give us a license to sin, but God's amazing grace gives us the power to say no to sin, to say no to temptation. I know the devil has power, but the devil, the only influence he has over you or over me is that we give to him. I'm glad, thank God, that the Holy Spirit that lives within us and the Word of God that we've been begotten with, if we have that in us, and listen to me, men, listen to me, women, husbands, love your wives, wives, respect your husbands, let's do it God's way. You can't beat God's way. Amen. You can't beat it. All right, here we go. So we see here that we need God's help. Amen? Notice this, it means power to say no to sin. This battle is one that goes on within our own bosom. This is the greatest battles men and women will ever have to fight. Even the Apostle Paul didn't want to become a reprobate or a castaway. He was afraid that after he had preached to others, he too would be lost. May God help us to sanctify the passions of life instead of abusing them. There's nothing more beautiful than for a husband to love his own wife and the wife to love her own husband. Thank God it works. Amen. All right, y'all with me? All right, I'm not tickling no ears today. I'm just preaching you the Word of God and the truth. All right, we see also about this sermon. It was not only a sermon of righteousness and temperance, but it was a sermon of the judgment to come. Paul told Felix of the judgment to come in which he must answer for the deeds of the body. He closes most of his arguments by referring to the resurrection of Jesus as the positive evidence of the resurrection and judgment of all humanity. This is the climax of his message. And I want to stop here and just say thank God that Jesus arose from the dead on the third day. And thank God every dear saint of God that passes from this life into heaven through the gate of death still lives. And we have hope. Because Jesus arose from the dead and became the first fruits of the resurrection. This life down here on earth doesn't end it for us. Thank God we just start living in another country, in another place. And my friend, if you don't know Jesus today, don't you think it's high time you come and meet him and ask him to save you from your sins and wash you in his blood? If you're backslidden, don't you think it's time that you come back to the Lord and rededicate your life? Yes, he now pictures the wrath of God to be visited upon the ungodly. Paul assures us in many other scriptures of the certainty of judgment, as it is appointed unto man once to die, after this the judgment. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ to give an account of the deeds done in our body, whether they be good or whether they be bad. Yes, the great reckoning day is coming, but I'm so glad that the blood of Jesus has been applied to my sins. And when I appear before the judgment seat, my sins will not be brought up because they've been washed and cleansed away through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I'm glad I'm facing him as friend and not as foe. I hope Jesus, my friend, is your friend. Do you know right now, if you were to die, that you would go to heaven? I think back when I went and saw Sister Carla's little grandpa. I went and saw Paul in the hospital. I didn't know that would be the last time that I would get to talk to this great man. But anyway, I talked to him. We had a good conversation. And I, you know, we talked about the Lord and being ready. And he told me several times, he said, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to meet Jesus. And The good Lord took him home a few days after that. My friend, death is coming to you and it's coming to me. If it doesn't come, that means we're going to be raptured out. We're going to be taken. Well, glory, that could happen today. The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ, is coming back for his church, thank God. Not a whole lot we can be too excited about in the country right now, but I tell you what I am excited about. I'm excited about our Lord's return. Ever how you believe it, hey, he's coming back, and when he comes back, I want to leave. I don't want to hang around. This old sin-cursed world, could I have an amen? We know God hath appointed a day. Listen to this. This is the Bible. God hath appointed a day. Everybody say a day. Into which he will judge the world. It will be no class judgment. Every man and woman will have to face the judge that day. There will be no escaping that day. Men and women often escape human courts, but they will not be able to escape God's court. It'll be a dark day for Ananias and Caiaphas, who robbed Jesus of every form of worship. It'll be a dark day for Pontius Pilate, who knew Jesus was innocent and yet condemned him to appease the Jewish mob. It'll be a dark day for the soldiers who mocked our Lord and spat upon him. It will be a dark day for Felix and all those who live in sin and open rebellion to the gospel's sweet call to their soul. My friend, Jesus is calling. He's tenderly calling your name to come to him and be saved. All right. Yes. My. Let's look fourthly at the results of the sermon. The Bible tells us Felix trembled. Under the powerful preaching of Paul, this ruler and judge trembles. The burning eloquence of Paul sent the truth home to the very heart of Felix. And like a tree in the midst of a great storm, his body shook with terror. That's what the power of God will do. How many longs for the day when the power of God will again shake sinners? Beloved, that's what it takes. It takes the power of the Holy Spirit. I can be an eloquent orator. That ain't what gets people saved. It's a spokesman, a mouthpiece, an ambassador for Christ that is faithful in delivering the message under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit grips the hearts of sinners that they can't stand their sins any longer. They must come forward. They must call upon Jesus and be saved. The greatest thing that could happen today is not that the courts would overturn the election, as much as I'd like it to be. Toward the candidate that I voted for, you know who he is. But anyway, I'll tell you after church if you want to know. You probably know who it is. That's not the greatest thing that could happen today. And I'd be happy about that. The greatest thing that could happen today is that one precious sinner would come to Jesus Christ and be saved. As much as it's important for us to plan and prepare for our life on earth, there's a much greater decision than that. Amen. And that's preparing to meet the Lord. Amen. In eternity. I hope if you're here today and you're lost, you don't have an assurance of your salvation, I hope you won't walk out of these doors. It's our heart's desire and our prayer that you'll come to Jesus. We'll have a brother or sister in Christ. We'll share with you the word of God, how you can be saved. I hope and pray you won't leave lost. If you're lost, it's our heart's desire you will leave saved. And God's people said, amen. The plain, pointed preaching of the truths of Jesus always makes sinners shake and cry out for mercy. The Philippian jailer fell at the feet of Paul and Silas and cried out these words, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" Did they say you got to join First Baptist Church of Jerusalem? Did they say you got to pay the Lord's tithes and give an offering when the plate's passed around? No. They say you got to live a good, clean, moral, righteous life? No, this is what they said. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thine house also. Jesus just don't want to save one person in the family. He wants to save the whole family. He wants to get the devil out of everybody in the family. Amen. He wants to save lost souls. Anybody in this house glad he saved your soul? Thank God I'm, amen, Brother Vernon. Thank God I'm not dying and going to a devil's hell. I'm going to die someday if the rapture don't take place. But I'm going to wake up right in front of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I say, praise be unto God. I'm glad I know who I believe in. I'm glad he lives in my heart today. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, I feel like shouting. Thank you, Lord. Yes. After Peter's wonderful sermon on the day of Pentecost, trembling, convicted people of all nations of the earth, they cried out, "Men and brethren, what shall we do? God, give us men who will preach Jesus with such power and force that men and women, boys and girls, will be convicted of their sins." The results of the sermon, Felix trembled. But here's the sad thing. Felix procrastinated. Trembling with fear, he says to Paul, "Go thy way, for this time when I have a convenient season, I will call thee." But the convenient season, that word season there means time. The convenient time never came, and Felix sank deeper and deeper into iniquity. Someone said there are two sworn enemies of the soul. Their names are yesterday and tomorrow. Yesterday slays her thousands by plunging them down into darkness and despair. She cries to her waiting subjects, "You had your chance and opportunities, and you've trampled them under your feet. They're gone forever." But tomorrow slays her tens of thousands. She cries, "Your brave vows and good resolutions will be easier for you tomorrow." And thus she sways her subject into the sleep of a convenient season. And my friend, hell is full of people just like Felix that were shook by the power of the Spirit of God, but they resisted the Lord one time too many, and now they are burning in the flames of hell. I have to tell you that because, number one, I got to give an account to the Lord. And number two, because the Lord does not delight in the death of the wicked. Sinner friend, the Lord don't want you to die and go to hell. That's why he went to Calvary's cross and shed his blood. You say, "You know, I've had a doubt in my mind. I've really wrestled with this. I've wondered, am I really right with God?" Well, friend, quit your wondering and make your calling and election sure in Jesus Christ. If I didn't know I was saved, if I didn't know I was going to heaven, if something were to happen to me this very moment or today, you couldn't keep me in that pew. I'd run to this altar and I'd make sure I was saved and I was ready to meet the Lord. Amen? Oh my. Tomorrow may never come. This leads us finally to this question. Well, why did Felix procrastinate? We're prone to ask just here, why did he do it? Why did he send Paul back to the guard room? Why didn't he accept Christ as his Savior right there on the spot? Well, I've got a few things to share with you, and we'll be coming to the end of the message. Number one, He procrastinated because he didn't want to give up his sins. His sins had become chains that were almost impossible to break. But we know the great chain breaker, don't we? Can Jesus break the chains of sin? You better believe he can. Can Jesus take an old drunk and save him or her and make him sober and give him eternal life? You better believe it. Can Jesus take a whoremonger and an adulterer and a thief and a murderer and a blasphemer? Can Jesus get them and break the chains of that sin and make them free and forgive them and save, gloriously save their soul from sin and give them eternal life? Can Jesus do it? Yes, because I'm looking at everybody in this room and you're looking at me. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Jesus didn't come short. Jesus was the glory of God, and he still is the glory of God. And if you want to get to heaven and you want to get to God the Father, you got to go through Jesus. Hey, he's the only one that can save a lost soul. Yes, his companionship with Drusilla was like the tentacle of the octopus about his neck. He didn't want to give up his sins. Like the hog, he found pleasure in wallowing in the mire. How many people today are entranced by the lust and the pleasures of this world? My friend, these pleasures are going to dissipate. They're going to disappear. They're going to go away. But the man or woman that does the will of God, the man or woman, boy or girl, who's been begotten with the incorruptible seed of the Word of God, will live forever, will praise forever, will glorify God throughout all eternity. Anybody in this house glad you're saved today? Thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise his holy name. Yes, please listen to me. Many people expect to give their sins up someday, but they beg a few more days to gratify their carnal desires. Let's just simply put it, they just don't want to give up their sins now. But the Bible tells us, if you ever do it, you'll have to do it now at the present. Now is the accepted time. Behold, today. Everybody say today. Say it again. Today. One more time. Today is the day of salvation. Not next week. Not tomorrow. Not when you get home today. You might not make it to your earthly home. Right now is your time. You've played around with your soul long enough. You need to come to Jesus. Please don't be like Felix. As far as we know about Felix, he never came to know Jesus Christ. It's not recorded in the inspired Word of God. Why else did he procrastinate? Well, he didn't want to give up the honors of the world. Like too many people today, he coveted the world's honor. My friend, to become a follower of Christ, it meant Felix would give up the governorship of the Roman province. It meant that he must bow in subjection to the lowly Nazarene. He must bow in subjection to the Lord Jesus Christ. Hundreds, no doubt thousands of people, millions of people today are sacrificing their soul for honor and social distinction. The applause of the people is far better in their estimation than the call to eternal things. They're willing to sacrifice redemption, immortality, and eternal life for the gratification of temporal ambitions. Remember when Satan took our Lord Jesus Christ to an exceedingly high mountain, and he showed him the glories of the world, and he offered them all if the Lord would just fall down and worship him? What did our master say to him? He gives us the example that you and I, when we're faced with the devil, we need to say to him. How did he answer Satan? Listen, he said, "For it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." Why did Felix procrastinate? Thirdly, he was just too busy. My goodness. He was too busy with worldly matters. Many people today are likewise so busy with their temporal pursuits that they have no time for Christ. Just a few days ago, and I could show it to you if I've still got this in my Bible. I don't have it in here, but I had on a sheet. I'd written on a blue sheet like this. Several people to pray for. I had all their names down. I probably called about every one of those names. And of all those names, there's like three or four. And to my understanding, they all were Christians. And you know what? I put it after their name. I put a check. And I wrote after that check mark, promoted. Amen. Thank God. That's what death is for a Christian. That's what the rapture of the church is for the Christian. It's promotion day. God's taken us out of this corruptible world that we're living in, and He's taken us to the incorruptible place that's called heaven. And I say, thank God, I'm ready to go. Are you ready to go? Thank God. Most of these people, all these ones that I had down there, most of them, about every one of them passed away just recently. My friend, I hope you're not too busy with law, with politics, with medicine, with science. Too busy in the mad rush for wealth. This is a wonderful and also a most terrible age in which we're living. My question to you is this. Are you procrastinating? Are you a slave to your sins? Do you prefer the honors of the world to those of Christ? Are you too busy to let the Master into your life, your home, and your business? There's an old story that the peasants of southern Russia talked about. An old woman who was at work in her house when the wise men of the east, led by the star, passed on their way to go and seek the infant Savior and King. They said to this little woman, remember this is just a story, but it, boy, there's a great truth in it. Come with us, they said. We're going to find Christ, so long looked for by men. Not now, she replied. I'm not ready to go now, but by and by I will follow on and find him with you. But when her work was finished, the wise men had gone, and the star in the heavens which went before them had disappeared. Many people say that they're going to find the Christ sometime, but they procrastinate. And after a while, the star of hope disappears forever. Some people think they've got a long time to come to Jesus, when, my friend, you may just have a short time to come to Christ. And we want to stand to our feet, and we want to give you an opportunity. The Master is calling you today. If you're not right with the Lord, or you need assurance of your salvation, we want to invite you to come to Jesus today. As they get a song, would every head be bowed, every eye closed? Thank you for your attention today. Would there be someone here today say, you know, preacher, church, I'm not for sure whether I'm ready to meet the Lord, whether I'm saved or not. I need to get saved. I'm not right with God. I want to make sure. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Would you just raise your hand and say, pray for me, please. I'm not right with the Lord. I need to come to Jesus. Would you raise your hand? Anybody at all? Friend, all I've done is obeyed the Holy Spirit and preached to you the gospel. I can't save you. Nobody here can save you, but Jesus can. Would you just slip your hand up and say, please pray for me? Anybody at all? Are you here today and you're out of fellowship with God? It's what we call a backslider. You're out of fellowship with God. You know you've been saved, but you need to rededicate your life to Christ. Would you raise your hand and say, that's me, preacher. I know I've been saved, but God bless you. I see that hand. Somebody else, pray for me. I'm not where I once was with Christ. I need to get right with the Lord. Will you pray for me? Anybody else? One more question. You're saved and you know that you're saved, trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you raise your hand good and high? You can raise both of them. Praise the Lord. Give Him honor. Give Him glory. Aren't you glad you're saved today? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God. Friend, I thank you for your honesty. Everybody didn't raise their hand. But guess what? You are close to coming to Jesus. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saved. If you realize you're lost, that's a good place to be in order to be saved. Because you know what? A lot of people We can't lead to Christ because they don't realize they're lost. Please, don't die without the Lord. Don't die and go to hell. We don't want you to die and go to hell. We want you to come to Jesus and call upon Him and be saved. Would you just slip your hand up and say, "Preacher, please pray for me. I know I'm not right with the Lord. Will you pray for me? I need to get right with the Lord." Would you just slip your hand up? I'm not going to come there to you. I'm not going to embarrass you. Would you just raise your hand? Dear Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for anointing us. Now, Father, as we sing this song, whoever you're speaking to, help them, Lord, to make their way to this old-fashioned altar and get right with you before it's too late, and we'll praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. As we sing, will you come right now? Come on.
Shackled by a heavy burden.
Just need to come to the altar. Come on and pray. Amen.
The load of
someone else. Same. Amen.
He touched me.
He touched me.
Oh, he touched me.